Je l'admire. Alors, elle est professeure à l'Université Cornell Dublin en Irlande. C'est une économiste. Et je l'admire parce que, en tant qu'économiste, elle se penche sur des sujets qui sont, les inégalités sociales en santé. Ce n'est pas le classique de l'économie. Et puis, donc, elle se centre sur l'importance de la prévention de la petite enfance en utilisant son expertise d'économiste. Et ça fait de très, très belles choses au niveau méthodologique, comme vous allez le voir lors de sa présentation. Je l'admire aussi parce qu'elle a passé les 8 dernières années de sa vie à faire ce projet qui s'appelle Preparing for Life. Et donc, elle est un exemple de comment persister dans un projet, s'investir dans un projet, y croire au départ et puis le traiter avec une rigueur scientifique et méthodologique, ça peut faire de très belles choses. Preparing for Life, c'est un programme de soutien pour les mères vulnérables et leurs enfants. Et comme vous allez voir, les résultats à moyen terme, c'est-à-dire au début de l'entrée dans la scolarité vers 6 ans, en Irlande, scolarité irlandaise, montrent des différences de QI de 10 points entre les enfants qui ont reçu, les familles qui ont reçu l'intervention et ceux qui ne l'ont pas reçu. Ce sont des tailles d'effets qui sont très grandes et très impressionnantes. Ce qui donne à penser que, pour les résultats court terme de ce projet, qui sont supérieurs à des programmes dont vous entendez parler toujours, si vous connaissez les interventions de la petite enfance, comme le Peer Preschool ou la Bicidarian, qui sont des programmes qui ont été faits dans les années 60 aux États-Unis. Eh bien, ces programmes-là, qui ont été faits dans des contextes très, très, très différents, au niveau de la population qui ciblait et au niveau du soutien social qui était en place aux États-Unis dans ces années-là, sont devenus un peu obsolètes, on peut penser, mais pourtant ce sont ces résultats-là qui donnent à penser aux politiciens scientifiques que les interventions de la petite enfance sont efficaces, qu'on devrait en faire des politiques sociales, qu'on devrait investir massivement une bonne portion de notre PIB dans la petite enfance, etc. L'évidence est très, très mince et repose sur quelques essais et quelques personnes qui ont eu des résultats exceptionnels. Donc, l'importance des travaux de Orla, elle est grande parce qu'elle fait la modernité en programme de prévention dans un contexte européen. C'est un des premiers, ou peut-être le premier, essai de ce type, vraiment avec une intensité sur 5 ans, qui est fait en Europe, dans un contexte où il y a du soutien social de l'État, contrairement aux États-Unis, il y en a beaucoup moins. Et un dernier point que Christophe soulevait, l'intervention n'est pas high-tech encore, mais nous répondons à un appel européen de l'Union européenne pour faire des collectes de données de sang, de matériel biologique, et donc pouvoir étudier éventuellement l'impact épigénétique du programme sur les signatures épigénétiques en lien avec le développement à long terme des enfants. Donc, c'est un projet très prometteur dont elle va nous parler. Merci beaucoup, Orla. Orla est ici, je voudrais le souligner, pour 6 mois. Et donc, je vous invite à profiter de sa présence pour travailler avec. Merci.
Thank you, Sylvana, for that wonderful introduction. I understood 50% of it. It was great. Yeah, I'm getting better. Good morning, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here and to have the opportunity to present to you today. Some of you may have heard me speak about this study last week, but I think today we have longer, so I can go into more depth about the study. So in this program, or this study, we're testing the effectiveness of an early intervention program which begins during pregnancy and continues until age 5, and we're doing that in Ireland. But first, a little bit of background. So there's now a growing evidence base which suggests that the circumstances which we are exposed to as a child are really critical for developing the skills which you need to lead a successful life. So children who are exposed to poor prenatal and postnatal environments, they typically have poorer health in adulthood. They have poorer educational outcomes and poorer labour market outcomes as well. And traditionally, human capital models within the economics literature in which I'm based, they would propose that children's skills, children's abilities are determined by inputs of time and market outcomes, or sorry, market goods, which basically means parental investments in the child, parental time investments in the child, and financial investments in the child. And we see social inequalities emerge in children's skills. So children from different social groups have different levels of skills. Those from higher social groups tend to have better skills than those from lower social groups. And the human capital model would suggest that this is because of differences in the availability of these inputs of time and money in the household. So these inputs, time and money, have both a direct effect on the development of children's skills and abilities, but they may also just serve as proxies for the quality of the environment that the child is being exposed to. Okay? And we have a number of empirical studies now, mainly from psychology, but more recently in economics, which shows that the quality of the home environment, parenting skills, parenting knowledge, and the level of parental stimulation that parents provide for their children are critical in determining children's skills and the level of children's skills. So as a consequence, economists finally caught up, and traditional human capital models have now been amended to also capture measures of parenting and the home environment. And now we have several economic models of parenting that exist out there. And the basic idea is that families from low socioeconomic backgrounds, they face financial constraints, and this limits their ability to invest in their children. But such families may also face constraints regarding parenting. Okay? And there is some evidence that suggests that parents from lower socioeconomic backgrounds engage in poorer parenting styles. They tend to engage in either more permissive parenting or harsh parenting styles. There is also evidence that they provide less academic stimulation for their children as well. And a number of studies have recently emerged which have argued that the reason perhaps that parents from low SES backgrounds engage in poorer parenting styles is due to the stress which poverty places on their own stress levels, their cognitive function, and their decision-making capabilities. So the basic premise is that the demands of dealing with poverty and living in poverty, it consumes your mental resources. And our mental resources are not limitless. So parents from low SES backgrounds have less available mental resources to invest in their children as their mental resources are being used to deal with the demands of poverty. And that is kind of a new hypothesis that is being proposed to explain these differences across social groups in parenting. So if we really want to try to reduce social inequalities in children's skills, early intervention programs which try to reduce the cognitive effort associated with parenting and try to improve parental stimulation with their children, this may be an effective strategy. One of the issues, however, is much of this early intervention literature and much of the evidence that we have that these types of programs are effective are based on centre-based preschool programs like PERI and like Abecedarian that Silvana mentioned. These programs start at age 3 and they target children, not parents. But if we really believe that the prenatal period and the infancy period is critical for optimising your brain development, and that parenting and the quality of the home environment is strongly implicated in the development of children's skills, then intervening earlier in the life cycle and intervening with parents may be a more effective strategy than centre-based preschool programs on which the majority of this literature is based. So programs which start early and work with parents are typically home visiting programs. These are programs which provide help and support to parents in their own home from pregnancy onwards. There have been a number of meta-analyses of the effectiveness of these programs, and they have found evidence of both short and long-term effects, although there's very few home visiting programs that have actually continued following the families into adulthood. There's one, basically, Nurse Family Partnership, and they're only at age 20, so it's still quite early days. But another issue with this literature is all these studies are based on studies from America, from the US, from North America. There's almost no evidence that early intervention programs, or indeed home visiting programs, are going to be effective in countries with more generous social welfare systems. And I guess you could hypothesize that, you know, you might expect social inequalities in children's health and in children's skills to be much lower in Europe, where many European countries provide universal health insurance, generous welfare payments, and a social safety net that really tries to protect the most vulnerable in society. But we do. We continue to see inequalities in children's skills in Europe and in children's health as well. We see inequalities within countries. We see inequalities between countries. So what this suggests is that it's not income alone that is driving these inequalities, and it might be something else. So the expanded human capital model, which also includes, which now accounts for parenting and parenting knowledge and parenting skills, not just resources and material resources, this may prove a more informative model for testing whether or not early intervention programs actually work in Europe. And that's what we're trying to do in this study. So in this study, we're using a randomized controlled trial where we experimentally modified the type of environments which children experience through a home visiting program to investigate whether these early intervention programs can be effective within a European setting, within Ireland, at least for the moment. The name of the program, as Silvana mentioned, is Preparing for Life, and it was one of the first, and it is the longest running experimental early intervention in Europe. It is operating in a highly disadvantaged community in Dublin, in Ireland. There's high rates of unemployment, high rates of crime, drug use, very low levels of education. And the program was developed because not only was there's a lot of social problems in this community, but the children were also performing well below the norm, both before they started school and then once they started school. The gap between high and low SES children widened. It didn't get narrow. So education wasn't helping to narrow the gap. So the aim of this program was to improve the children's skills by giving parents the techniques and skills that they needed to help develop these skills in their own children. So starting back in 2008, we recruited pregnant women. You'll notice the little babies in the belly, pregnant women. And we randomly assigned 115 to the high treatment group and 118 to the low treatment group. Both groups received 5 low-level services. So both groups received 100 euros worth of child development materials and book packs every year they were in the program. Both groups received 1 year free childcare. So that equivalized the childcare across both groups. Both groups were encouraged to attend public health workshops on stress control and healthy eating. Both groups had an information worker who could help them access other services in the community that were unrelated to parenting or child development. And finally, both groups were invited to take part in PFL special events like Christmas parties and summer parties and sports days and kind of community events to get the project accepted within the community. But what the program is really about are these 3 additional intensive parenting supports that are only provided to the parents in the high treatment group. And I'm going to explain those now. So first, the main treatment is a home visiting program. This home visiting program, like all home visiting programs, is based on theories of attachment, social learning, and ecological development. In the PFL program, every family in the high treatment group had a mentor. The mentor visited the family home once every 2 weeks, starting during pregnancy and continuing until age 5. So this is an incredibly long, it's an incredibly intensive and therefore incredibly expensive intervention. I'm not going to lie, it is expensive. The mentors came from different professional backgrounds like education, psychology, family care, but they were all trained in the Preparing for Life program. It's a Manulife program, and they were specifically hired to implement the program. That's all they did. They implemented this program. And the mentor's role was really to support and educate parents around child development and parenting using a variety of different techniques like role play, demonstration, encouragement, and feedback. And each of the home visits was structured around a group of 210 different tip sheets. These tip sheets really were kind of colorful handouts just describing how to promote certain behaviors in their child. For example, here's one about the importance of listening and talking with your children. There's 210 of them. The tip sheets were delivered based on the age of the child and the needs of the family. And if you look at this graph here, you can see that the majority of the tip sheets, 60% of the tip sheets, were really focused on promoting the child's physical health and well-being. About 34% were focused on promoting the child's social and emotional well-being, and then somewhat less on approaches to learning, language development, and cognitive development. So there is, if you like, a skew towards health. That wasn't planned. I think it was just the types of tip sheets that they developed. It was easier to develop tip sheets for health than some of the other issues. I genuinely believe that's why that happened. Okay, the second main treatment was baby massage classes. So the parents were invited to take part in baby massage when their children were between 0 and 10 months old. The real aim of these classes was to give parents the skills to relax and stimulate their infants, but more importantly, to encourage the importance of communication between mothers, fathers, and very young infants as well. And they took part in 5 baby massage classes of 2 hours each. The final treatment then is the Triple P Positive Parenting Program. This is a universal program developed by the University of Queensland. It aims to promote healthy parenting behaviors and encourage parents to engage in what is called positive parenting. This program is operating all around the world. There have been multiple meta-analyses examining the effectiveness of this program, and it has been shown to have effects both on parents and on children as well, in terms of children's socio-emotional well-being. It's a multi-level intervention, but in preparing for life, Group Triple P is what was offered. Group Triple P was where parents came together in small groups of 10 parents for 5 weeks, and the mentors would work through videos, vignettes, and role play all about how to encourage positive parenting. And this took place when the children were between the ages of 2 and 3. So this diagram here just kind of presents the timing of all the preparing for life treatments. So in the top panel, you have all the treatments that are for the high treatment group. So you can see that the home visits and tip sheets went from pregnancy until school entry at age 4 and a half really. You can see the baby massage classes were in the first year, the Triple P parenting program was in the second year. Then the supports that went to both groups, we've got 4 book packs that were delivered between 3 months and 3 and a half. There was 5 toy packs delivered between pregnancy and age 4. And then the social events and public health workshops, they took place throughout the program. So this is basically the entire treatments that took place within the program. Okay, so the eligibility criteria for the program included a cohort of all pregnant women who were living in the Preparing for Life catchment area between 2008 and 2010. We recruited a sample in the local maternity hospital. On average, the women were 20 weeks pregnant when they joined, but there was huge variability. So some parents joined when they were like literally 4 weeks pregnant, some joined when they were 40 weeks pregnant and just about to give birth. So there was wide variability in when they joined. It's very important to say this is a voluntary program. There was no referrals, no one forced these parents to join the program, completely voluntary. And what we found was just about 50%, about half of all eligible women who lived in the community decided to join the program. As soon as they joined, we randomly assigned them to the treatment, the high treatment or the low treatment, using an unconditional probability randomization strategy, which is just pure randomization, no stratification, no block design. In order to test whether our randomization procedure worked or not, we tested for baseline equivalence of the high and low treatment group using 116 different baseline measures that we collected before the program began. And we found that there was no statistically significant differences across the two groups on 92% of the measures. So we were pretty confident that our randomization worked. And I'm not presenting all 116, but here's a couple of those baseline characteristics. Just to give you a sense of what this sample looked like, okay? So on average, the women were about 25 years old when they joined the program. About half of them were first-time parents, and this is really important because most home visiting programs only target first-time parents. In Preparing for Life, any parent is eligible to join. Very low rates of marriage, only about 14% were married during pregnancy. About 30% had low levels of education, which is leaving school at 16 or before. Only 3% of the sample had a college education, so a university degree. About 40% of the sample were unemployed. 55% were living in social housing. I guess in France, this is social housing or public housing, well, housing provided by the government, basically. 10% of the sample had a long-term chronic physical illness, but as you can see, almost 30% or 25% of the sample had a previously diagnosed mental health condition. So mental health problems in this community are very prevalent. 30% of these pregnancies were planned, which means that 70% of these pregnancies were unplanned. 50% of the sample were smoking during pregnancy, and close to 30% of the sample were drinking during pregnancy. So what this shows is a kind of fairly typical disadvantaged sample, low SES sample, at least in Ireland. Okay, so as part of our evaluation, we've conducted both an impact evaluation to determine why the program works, or if the program works, and an implementation evaluation to determine why the program might work. We've collected a lot of data. So we've conducted interviews with the mothers in the home at 7 time points between baseline and 48 months. We've conducted direct assessments with the children when they were 4 years old, where we measured their cognitive development and their executive functioning. When the children started school, we asked the teachers to complete the short early development inventory to measure their levels of school readiness. We've also accessed the birth records for the children and their hospital records. We've also collected maternal physiological data using wrist-mounted biosensors, and we've also collected diary data as well. As part of our implementation evaluation, we've collected data on treatment intensity, so dosage, so how much treatment the parents actually received. We've conducted focus groups using qualitative methods with both mothers in the program and fathers in the program. We've conducted semi-structured interviews with all the mentors and program staff. And we've also more recently conducted semi-structured interviews with the children. So now that the children are 4 or 5 years old, we can actually talk to them properly. And they did talk and draw activities, puppet work, and a variety of different things with the children as well. Today, I'm focusing on the top three, okay, the quantitative data. Now, because this is a 6-year trial, okay, you join during pregnancy, you stay till age 5, of course there was attrition over time. So we started off with 115 in the high treatment group, and by our final assessment point in school, we had retained 75% of the sample. The equivalent figures are 118 in the low treatment group and 74 at the end. So as you can see, the level of attrition across both groups is pretty equivalent. It was about 35%, which it's good that it was equal in both groups. We also wanted to test for differential attrition. So if the types of people who stayed in the program are different from the types of people who left the program, and if there was differences across treatment and control. So using those 116 baseline measures, we looked at what factors predicted drop or staying in the study, and we actually found that very few baseline characteristics predicted whether or not a mother or family would stay in the study or not. All we found was that mothers in the high treatment group who stayed in the study till the end, they had higher IQ themselves, and they were more likely to be employed during pregnancy. In the low treatment group, we found that the mothers who stayed in the program were older, they had more children, and they had greater knowledge of child development before the program began. So we have some evidence, if you like, that the parents with better characteristics were more likely to stay in the program. So we need to adjust for this in our analysis, which we use using inverse probability weighting, which I'll discuss now. So we estimate our treatment effects using a variety of different statistical methods. We have a relatively small sample size, so we use permutation-based hypothesis testing rather than standard t-tests. T-tests are based on large sample assumptions. We don't have a large sample, therefore t-tests are not appropriate, whereas permutation tests are distribution-free, so it's better to use them when you have a small sample and your data is more likely to be non-normally distributed. Secondly, as I just showed you, there was some evidence of attrition in the sample, although not differential attrition. However, just to control for the fact that there could be unobservable characteristics that we are not capturing, we control for differential attrition using the inverse probability weighting procedure. This is where we use our baseline data to predict the probability of staying in the sample at each time point. We then use the inverse of those predicted probabilities as weights in our outcome analyses. So what this means is we're giving a larger weight to people who are present in the sample, but they look like people who are no longer present in the sample. And then finally, because we are looking at so many different outcomes at the same time, this increases the likelihood of making a type 1 error. So we adjust for multiple hypothesis testing using the step-down procedure by Romano and Wolf. We've also tested the robustness of our results by using standard t-tests, by not controlling for differential attrition, by controlling for other baseline variables, and basically we find our results are very robust. Regardless of what we do, we cannot get rid of these results. So the results I'm going to present to you today were all estimated using inverse probability weighted permutation tests where we control for gender. And we control for gender because there was a baseline imbalance in the treatment, baseline imbalance in gender. So there was more boys in the treatment group than girls. So we want to control for that. Because generally boys have worse outcomes than girls, in childhood at least. They catch up. Okay, so firstly I'm going to present the results that we found during the program. Okay, so what this is, there's a lot going on in this table. What this table shows is the proportion of measures on which there were statistically significant differences between the high and the low treatment group at 6, 12, 18, 24, 36, and 48 months. I'm going to report two proportions. The first proportion are the proportion of differences that were statistically significant from the individual tests. And then the second column is the proportion of differences that were statistically different in the step-down, or if you like, the multiple hypothesis-adjusted tests. The first domain that we look at is obviously the most important, is child development. At any time point, we've included between 14 and 43 different measures of child development. And as you can see, in the early days, we had absolutely no evidence. There was no evidence that the program had any impact on the children's development. It really wasn't until the children reached 2 years old, 24 months, that we started to see significant differences between the high and the low treatment group regarding our child development measures. So at 24 months, on 36% of all the child development measures we assessed, there were statistically significant differences across the two groups. And by the end of the program, on almost 50% of the child development measures that we assessed, the high treatment group were performing significantly better than the low treatment group. We saw a very different pattern when we looked at child health. So child health, we started to see effects from really early on. From as early as 6 months, we saw effects on children's health, which continued through until the end. They peaked at 24 months, when we saw on half of all the measures that we assessed, the high treatment group has significantly better scores, and then the effects on health tend to reduce, although we're still present towards the end of the program. The types of effects that we found for health were on nutrition, the types of foods that the parents were feeding their children, there was effects on immunization, what other health effects, there was effects on BMI, okay, so they were mainly around food, immunization, and weight that we found the child health effects. In terms of parenting, it's a parenting program, so we hypothesized we would see lots of effects on parenting. That hypothesis didn't work. We found very few effects on measures of parenting knowledge and skills. We found effects on parental behavior, but not on knowledge and skills. So as you can see, the proportions are relatively low, kind of averaging about 15% over the course of the program. So this was somewhat surprising. We saw that the program impacted children, although didn't necessarily impact on parents. And the final area that we assessed was the quality of the home environment. At every second time point, we measured this using this measure called a home observation measurement of the environment. It's a very well-known scale. When we use that at every second time point, we find an awful lot of significant treatment effects, but when we don't use it, we don't. So what this suggests is that the program had an impact on certain dimensions of the home environment, but not on others. So the types of areas where we found effects were in terms of the high treatment group provided more learning materials, there was more interactions, there was more stimulation. So there was more of exactly the type of thing that the program was trying to do. And if we just summarize the total number of statistically significant differences at each time point, we see that they generally increased over time. So from 13%, a fall at 12 months to 6%, 13% again at 18 months, 34% at 24 months, 30% at 36 months, and 26% at 48 months. So again, this is all higher than the proportion you would expect if the program was having no impact. But what I'm really going to concentrate on now, So what I'm really going to concentrate for the rest of the presentation is the impact that the program had at the end of the program. Right, so where we really asked the question, did this program actually achieve its aim of improving the children's school readiness skills? And we measure this in five ways. We measure children's cognitive development, their language development, their approach to learning, their socio-emotional development, and their physical well-being and motor development. So these are the generally considered the five domains of school readiness. And while those results I showed you between 6 and 48 months are all based on parent report, these are based on direct assessments that we conducted with the children and based on teacher reported data as well. Okay. So, and I'll describe what is what when we go through. So the first area that we looked at is the children's cognitive development. We measured this using the British Ability Scales, which is a direct assessment we conducted when the children were about 51 months old. All the tables I show you will take the following format. We show the mean and standard deviation of the treatment, the high treatment group, mean and standard deviation of the low treatment group, the p-value that results from an inverse probability weighted permutation test, the p-value that results from our IPW weighted permutation test adjusted for multiple hypothesis testing, and the effect size, either measured in Cohen's D for continuous outcomes or odds ratios for binary outcomes. So firstly, this is these, if you like, some of the main results. We found that the children in the high treatment group have significantly higher cognitive scores than those in the low treatment group. So children in the high treatment group had better general conceptual ability, they had higher spatial ability, and higher pictorial reasoning. You can see that all these differences are statistically significant, and all these differences are clinically significant. If you look at the effect sizes, we're talking about Cohen's D of between 0.5 and 0.7, which are considered pretty reasonable effect sizes for Cohen's D, particularly within this literature, where the average effect size for cognition is usually 0.2. And if you just actually look at the magnitude of the effects, like 97.7 for the high treatment, 88 for the low treatment, this represents about a 10-point difference in IQ across the high and low treatment, which is much larger than basically any other types of interventions that you typically find in this field. We also found that the program had an impact at different ends of the distribution. So the children in the high treatment group were less likely to score below average concerning their general conceptual ability, their spatial ability, and pictorial reasoning. Again, these differences are statistically significant, but they're also clinically significant. We're seeing odds ratios of between 2 and 6, and 6 for the overall measure of cognition. And if you again just look at the magnitude of the effects, so we find that 20% of the high treatment group are scoring below the average. So the BAS is a normed measure, you know, nationally representative norm measure. So 20% of the high treatment group are scoring below the norm, but 60% of the low treatment group are scoring below the norm. Okay, just look at the numbers, it's a large difference. We also found that the program had an effect at the upper end of the distribution, although the effects were a little smaller. So children in the high treatment group were more likely to score above average concerning their general conceptual ability and their pictorial reasoning. No significant differences for spatial ability. Again, statistically significant results and clinically significant. Again, if you look at general conceptual ability, 25% of the sample are scoring above average compared to just 8% in the low treatment group. And our final then measure of cognition, our teacher reported scores on the children's literacy children's numeracy skills. So the teachers reported that the children in the high treatment group had higher numeracy skills than those in the low treatment group, and they were also less likely to be rated as scoring not on track in terms of their numeracy skills as well. And again, statistically significant results with an odds ratio of 2 there for the binary outcome. So there are the results for cognition. The next slide then, we just map the distribution of the children's GCA scores. This is their overall measure of IQ, basically. The blue line is the low treatment group, the green line is the high treatment group, and what you can see is the distribution of the high treatment group is shifted, or has shifted, to the right of the distribution of the low treatment group. What this tells us is that the program has seemed to impact the children at every point in the distribution, not just those scoring very low or very high, but it seemed to shifted the entire distribution, which actually was the aim of the program while it was being developed. Okay, next we looked at the children's language development, also measured using the British Ability Scales. And again, here we find that the program has significant impact on language. Children in the high treatment group were more likely to score higher, or scored higher, in terms of their verbal ability. They were less likely to score below average, and they were more likely to score above average. When we looked at the different types of verbal ability, we found that the program impacted both naming vocabulary and verbal comprehension. So all types of language development seems to have been impacted. Again, statistically significant results, and again, with quite large or at least moderate effect sizes as well. Then we looked at teacher reports of the children's language skills using the short early development inventory. And here we have a measure of children's communication and literacy skills as reported by teachers. And here we find somewhat different results. So we find that the teachers reported that the children in the high treatment group had significantly higher communication scores than the low treatment group, but there was no differences regarding emergent literacy skills, basic or advanced literacy skills. Apart from some of the cutoff scores, so we found that children in the low treatment group were less likely to score a below average or be not on track in terms of communication and emerging literacy skills. So if you like, these results are somewhat different from those results we got using direct assessments. And this is kind of normal. You often find different results depending on who's making the reporting. Is it a parent report? Is it a teacher report? Is it direct assessments? And you're going to see across all our teacher reported scores, we always find less significant results than our direct assessments. But direct assessments are considered a much more reliable indicator of children's real abilities than teacher reported scores, but still just interesting to look at the differences. The next area that we looked at was children's approaches to learning. So do children like learning and are, you know, actively seek out learning? We measured this in a number of different ways. Firstly, we did it through direct assessments using two tests of executive functioning. Firstly, we used the day-night task, which I'm sure some of you are aware of. This is where you show a child a picture of a day sky and a night sky. And when the researcher says day, the child has to point to the night sky. When the researcher says night, the child has to point to the day sky. So it's trying to get the child to manage their attention and to override their automatic responses to give like the right answer. Okay? And they do this 15 times, or I think actually no, they do this 10 times. And we found that the program did have an impact on the children's ability to manage their attention. So the high treatment group were more likely to control themselves and not give the wrong answer than the low treatment group. However, we found that the program had no impact on the children's ability to delay gratification. You're probably aware of the famous Michel marshmallow tests for delay gratification. We weren't allowed to use marshmallows. We had to, because we can't give children marshmallows these days in the study, which is trying to promote healthy eating. So we weren't allowed to give them marshmallows. We were had to give them stickers. And I honestly think kids, these, you know, stickers, I don't know what the word is in French. Stick.
Yeah.
So I think kids these days are so used to getting stickers that there's no real intrinsic value in them anymore. So what we asked was, we told the children, we'll give you one sticker now, or we'll give you a whole book of stickers if you do one more task or one more game with us. And what we found was basically the majority of the sample, about 70% of both the high and the low treatment group, were able to say, no, it's fine, I'll wait. Okay. So I honestly think this result is more down to us not using a very good test rather than the program having no impact. But the program had no impact, according to this, okay, on delay of gratification. And in actual fact, the results from teachers would suggest this as well. So we have a number of teacher-reported scores on approaches to learning, and we found no statistically significant differences regarding overall approaches to learning, readiness to explore new things, and interest in literacy, numeracy, and memory. So no effects across any of those measures that we assessed. Okay, moving on to the next area was the children's social and emotional development. And here, here we only have teacher-reported scores. And we find some effects, but not a lot. So we found that teachers in the high treatment group, teachers reported that the children in the high treatment group were more likely to engage in less hyperactivity or inattentive behaviors in both the continuous score and the cutoff score. But there were no significant differences regarding aggressive behavior, anxious or fearful behavior, or oppositional and defiant behavior. Now, this is also in contrast with the results which we found during the program, where we measured the children's social and emotional well-being using the child behavioral checklist. So when we use a child behavioral checklist, we find significant treatment effects at every point on children's externalizing behavior, which is kind of counterintuitive to these results as well. So again, showing differences depending on reporter. We do find more treatment effects on positive behaviors, positive socio-emotional behaviors. So the teachers reported that children in the high treatment group had higher social competence with peers and had more autonomy, but no differences on pro-social and helping behavior, or responsibility and respect. And this is true in the continuous scores and the cutoff scores. Okay. The final area that we assess is the children's physical well-being. And here I'm only going to report like very few results. We have many, many more. Here is the data that we've collected from the children's hospital on the child's hospital use between birth, just after birth, and age 4. I presented some of these results last week. So firstly, we looked at overall hospital use in the first 4 years of life, and we found that there was no statistically significant differences on the number of times that the children in the high or low treatment group went to hospital for a unique health event. So it was about 4 times in the low treatment group, 5 times in the high treatment group. But we found that the high treatment group needed or required less follow-up services than the low treatment group, which meant that the high treatment group used less hospital services overall. So on average, the high treatment group used 6 hospital services between pregnancy, between birth and age 4, and the low treatment group, control group, used 10, so significantly higher amount. Then we looked at use of emergency department, and again, we found that almost everyone in the sample had been to the emergency department at least once before the age of 4. So over 97% of the sample had been to the emergency department at least once, and no difference across treatment and control. But if we look at the number of visits that children made to the emergency department, it was significantly lower for those in the high treatment group. High treatment group had 3.5 visits on average, compared to 4.5 visits on average for the low treatment group. And again, this is statistically significant. And we see the exact same pattern when we look at the emergency department clinic, where it's where you go to get your stitches changed and bandages changed, things like that. We also have results looking at actually what they end up going to hospital for, so what medical conditions they end up in the hospital for, and we don't really find any differences in why they go to the hospital. So I'm not reporting those. I'm just going to report one more table, which is their attendance at outpatient services. So we found that the children in the high treatment group were less likely to visit orthopedics, physiotherapy, ocular-related departments, or plastic surgery. No difference in general pediatrics, surgery, and actually for ear, nose, and throat, we find that more of the high treatment group attend outpatient services for those reasons. So these results are probably our newest results. We haven't actually written these up yet, but we are working with colleagues in a hospital in Dublin to do it. Okay, so the final measure, the final table, I promise, is the teacher-reported scores on the children's physical health and well-being. And we found that the teachers reported that the children had significantly better gross and fine motor skills and more physical independence. No differences in physical readiness for the study day. And again, we see similar story regarding we use continuous scores or the cutoff scores. So there are main results. Across the 5 domains of school readiness that we look at, we find significant treatment effects across all 5 domains. The majority of the effects and the strongest effects are based on those effects for direct assessments of the children's cognition and language. Okay, so how does this compare to all those other US home visiting programs? So what this table shows is basically a summary of three different meta-analyses of home visiting programs that were conducted primarily of US-based programs. What I'm reporting here is the average effect size in these meta-analyses for children's cognitive skills, socio-emotional skills, and physical health. Looking at the cognitive skills, you can see that on average, the meta-analyses tend to find effect sizes for cognition of between 0.18 and 0.3. If you compare this to, if you like, our best estimate of cognition, which was the GCA score from the BAS, is 0.7. So it's significantly larger than is typically found in US-based home visiting programs. For socio-emotional skills, the only meta-analysis to report on it was by Sweet and Applebaum, and they found the average effect size of 0.2. If you compare it, I haven't shown you this result, but if you compare it to like our best measure of children's socio-emotional skills, which is the CBCL, we found an effect size of 0.36, which again is larger than the effects found on average. Physical health, very few meta-analyses look at it. The Phelan one did, and they found an average effect size of 0.11. And again, if you compare this to one of our best estimates of health, which was overweight, whether or not the children were overweight when they were 4 years old, we found an effect size of 0.46. So again, it's somewhat larger. But of course, it's not really fair for me just to go, oh, look, it's better. Because there have been other individual home visiting programs that have found similar effects in the same magnitude as us. So the Abbasidarian program, which is one of the most well-known programs, which combined home visiting plus childcare, they found an average effect on cognitive skills at age 5 of 0.62, which is pretty equivalent to the 0.72 that we found. But if you look at the most famous home visiting program and most widely implemented home visiting program, the Nurse Family Partnership, they only found an effect size of 0.18 on cognitive skills when the children were 6 years old. So there's huge variability in the results that you get in home visiting programs. Of course, they all differ. So you would expect this. Now, so I'm just briefly, if I have a little bit of time, I'm going to talk a little bit about potential mechanisms. So why did the program have such an impact on children's skills? Well, during the program, we did look, we measured potential mechanisms like changes in parenting behavior. And we did find that the parents did change their behavior, even if they didn't change their attitudes. So we found that the high treatment children were living in higher quality home environments. They were living in homes where the parents provided a greater amount of stimulation. The children were exposed to a greater variety of activity in their daily lives. The parents provided more appropriate learning materials for their children. They were less likely to restrict children in their activities and their actions, and parents were more involved in their learning. We also found that parents in the high treatment group were less likely to engage in permissive parenting styles, which suggests there may have been some impact on that cognitive effort of parenting that I was talking about at the start of the presentation. So we found that the parents in the high treatment group found it easier to discipline their children when appropriate and to follow through with disciplinary practices, which obviously is very important for parenting. We also, just something that's very modern these days, we found that the children in the high treatment group were less likely, they basically had better screen time practices. So they watched less TV and DVDs and videos when they were 3 years old, and they spent less time watching television when they were 4 years old as well. And TV is a big thing in Ireland in these homes. TV's always on. So that's some potential mechanisms that may explain the results. I think it's very important to say where PFL had no impact, right? It had an impact on certain things, but there was no effects on other areas, and it's very important to say what they are. So there was no impact at all on birth outcomes. There's no impact on the child's birth weight, for example. Even though this was a prenatally commencing intervention that really tried to impact on things like birth weight by providing nutritional advice during pregnancy, by encouraging parents not to smoke and drink and take drugs during pregnancy, but there was no impact on birth weight. There was also no impact on parental health behaviors or parents' health. So, for example, there was no differences in breastfeeding. And Ireland has the lowest rate of breastfeeding in Europe. And there was no differences. So the program tried to improve breastfeeding, but it didn't succeed. There was also no differences in cigarette use during the program or in terms of parental depression as well. I suppose one of the biggest surprises was there was absolutely no impact on parental well-being. So we measured parental well-being at every single time point during the evaluation, and regardless of how we measured it, there was no effects. There was no effects on parental self-efficacy, parental self-esteem, or parental stress. So our main hypothesis for this is that this program was not effective in changing the parents' mental health, because it wasn't really designed to. It was designed to teach the parents how to be better parents, but not actually to deal with these deep-rooted psychological issues that many of these parents faced. And there was effects on parenting, many measures of parenting, but there were no effects on other areas of parenting, like parent-child attachment, no effects, and parental beliefs, no effects. And finally, and this is important, there was no differences in childcare use across the treatment or control group, which means that these results cannot be attributed to differences in childcare exposure. So I'm going to conclude now. So overall, PFL seemed to achieve its aim of getting children ready for school because it had impacts, at least some impacts, across every five domains of school readiness that we assessed. And the strongest effects were in children's cognition and health as well. We can show that these results are robust to small sample size, differential attrition, multiple hypothesis testing, differential misreporting, and contamination. I haven't even gone there today to present those results, but we have all those results done. The good news is that this program is currently being rolled out on a really small scale in Ireland, but it is still operating. We have plans to follow this cohort so it becomes a new Perry, if you like. We want to see if these effects fade out or do these effects stay. And has this program set the children up on a better life pattern? So we plan to follow the cohort when they're 9, 13, 17, 25 years, and 10 years after that, if we get funding, of course. We also want to do a replication of this RCT in other European countries. Because we show that it worked in Ireland, that doesn't mean it's going to work in France or Germany or the Netherlands or Czech Republic. So we want to try to replicate and do this RCT in other European countries, and we're currently preparing a Horizon 2020 proposal to do that. So if you'd like any more information on the program or the earlier R evaluation, you can check out our website where we have all our reports, all our presentations, and all our papers. So thank you.